Well, good evening and welcome to Roosevelt House. I'm Lawrence Mosley, Director of the Human Rights Program at Hunter College, which is based in this building, the former home of Franklin and Eleanor Roosevelt and Franklin's mother, Sarah. Sarah built these twin townhouses and gave one to Franklin and Eleanor as a wedding gift in 1908. It was here that Franklin recovered from polio in 1921, and he and Eleanor lived here until the very day he was inaugurated as president in March of 1933. So it is fitting that this building, infused with the spirit of Eleanor Roosevelt in particular, should now be the home of the Human Rights Program at Hunter College. Eleanor chaired a series of meetings at Hunter in April and May of 1946 to plan the establishment of the UN Commission on Human Rights. And after the formal creation of the commission in 1948, Eleanor was elected as its first chair. And in that role, she was a leading proponent and drafter of the Universal Declaration of Human Rights. As an interesting historical footnote before tonight's program, even as she was in the throes of negotiations over the drafting of the Universal Declaration, Eleanor threatened President Truman to resign in protest as a U.S. delegate to the United Nations, in protest when the U.S. State Department reversed itself and withdrew its support for the UN Partition Plan of 1948, which was the original two-state solution. And Truman then reaffirmed support for the Partition Plan, and Mrs. Roosevelt remained on the U.S. delegation and continued to lead the drafting of the declaration until it was adopted in December 1948. So the UN Partition Plan, embodied in General Assembly Resolution 181, provided that Jerusalem would be part of neither the Jewish state nor the Arab state, but a separate territory under the effective control of the United Nations. The 1948 war left the city divided between the new state of Israel and Jordan, with Israel proceeding to annex the western portions it controlled and Jordan the eastern portions, including the old city. After Israel occupied all of the West Bank in the 1967 war, it proceeded to annex East Jerusalem and declared the city united. In actuality, the city is anything but united, with very different citizenship, residency, and land use policies applying to Israelis and Palestinians. And the building of Israeli settlement communities far into the West Bank, especially surrounding Jerusalem, and of some even within East Jerusalem itself, have greatly complicated the prospects for a two-state solution, which remains the officially stated policy of the United States and of the State of Israel. This city of 800,000 people, roughly the size of Charlotte, North Carolina, looms much larger in international imagination as hallowed ground for the three major monotheistic religions, and it is central to the Israeli-Palestinian conflict as the self-declared capital of Israel and the city the Palestinians would also want as their capital. And during a research trip to Israel and Palestine in November, I made two trips through East Jerusalem, one with the Israeli Committee Against House Demolitions, and one with a remarkable Israeli-American lawyer, Daniel Seidemann. And I strongly recommend these eye-opening experiences if you have the chance to visit Jerusalem. We have the next best thing tonight, as Daniel Seidemann is in the United States this week, and we took the opportunity to ask him to speak to us here at Roosevelt House. Daniel was born into the Hunter family, his late mother, Shalomith Zimring Seidemann, having been a Hunter alumna, class of 1940. And we're proud his father, Hans Seidemann, is here with us this evening. And Danny attended Cornell and then emigrated to Israel, obtained his law degree at the Hebrew University in Jerusalem, served in the Israeli Defense Forces, rising to the rank of major, and opened a law practice in Jerusalem where he specialized in Israeli-Palestinian relations and argued more than 20 Jerusalem-related cases before the Israeli Supreme Court. His NGO, Terrestrial Jerusalem, has published his remarkable Geopolitical Atlas of Contemporary Jerusalem, copies of which will be available at the reception following this program. And I know no one better to explain the complexities of Jerusalem in all their great detail as they bear upon the prospects for peace between Israelis and Palestinians. Fortunately, we have the perfect person right here at Hunter College to interview Danny. Laura Schor, professor of history at Hunter and the CUNY Graduate Center, teaches a course here on Jerusalem in the 20th century. And in addition to a distinguished career as a historian of modern European history, women's history, and Jewish history, Laura served as the provost of Hunter College for 9 years, as the founding dean of the Macaulay Honors College, and as executive director of Hadassah. So I'm very pleased to turn the program over to Laura and Danny for what I expect will be a very interesting evening. Thank you.
So let's get right to it. Can you help us understand the parameters of Jerusalem as they changed from about the end of the Ottoman period, late 19th century, to where we are today?
I'll do my best. There should be a clicker here somewhere. One second. Here it is. There it is. Okay. Before I get started, let me give you a little bit about my approach to this. In the summer of 2000, just before the Camp David summit, I received a phone call on a Sunday afternoon in Jerusalem from the American negotiating team, which is a very compact, insular group. Danny, we're at the King David, can you come over? It's a regular work day in Jerusalem. I saunter across the park, and there I find the team, four people, the names of which I think you're probably familiar with. They didn't tell me what they were interested in discussing, and I hear the following immortal sentence. Danny, we're about to begin permanent status talks on Jerusalem. We don't know very much about the subject. Could you give us bar mitzvah lessons? This has subsequently been described as the best prepared summit since Yalta. All right. Now, I'm a map junkie. I need graphic people to make, I'm graphically challenged, but I make my own maps. But they didn't tell me what they wanted. So the preparation of the American negotiating team began by my drawing maps on napkins poolside at the King David Hotel. That's not accidental. Jerusalem is a radioactive issue. And passions run very high, and the knowledge doesn't always keep up. Dealing with radioactive issues for the last 25 years, I've discovered that the best way of dealing with radiation sickness is by being devoted to fact. The facts won't solve the issues, but they will, you know, they will keep the bad spirits away, and they save you a lot of grief. So what I would like to do is very briefly go through what has Jerusalem been over the last century, century and a half. Until the end of the 19th century, Jerusalem was the old city. That was all of Jerusalem. Anything outside of the ramparts of the old city was not Jerusalem. If you were unfortunate to arrive from Jaffa after dark, you would sleep in the fields because the gates would be closed at sunset. This was a medieval town. By the way, you can see remnants of this to this day. One of the epicenters of the conflict today is Silwan, immediately to the south of the old city of Jerusalem, known by Jews and settlers as the City of David. It is both. And if you ask the elderly in Silwan, which is literally a stone's throw from the ramparts of the old city, where do you live? They'll say, we live in Silwan. Where is Silwan? Oh, Silwan is near Jerusalem. It's literally 100 yards away, but it's near Jerusalem. The old city was divided into quarters. It was divided into quarters since the early Middle Ages, although only crystallized into the quarters as we know them in the 19th century. The image of there being homogeneous quarters of the old city is erroneous. There were Palestinians, Arabs, living in the Jewish quarter. Most of the land of the Jewish quarter was owned by Palestinians, approximately 70%. There were Jews living in the Muslim quarter. The only quarter that was really clearly identifiable and ethnically homogeneous was the Armenian quarter, and it remains so pretty much until today. Jerusalem began to develop outside of the walls during the 19th century, but it really came to fruition during the British Mandate. And the British brought the norms of modern governance to Jerusalem in ways we had not witnessed before. And even to this day, when you look at the underpinnings of Jerusalem, much of it was created during the British Mandate, and much of the tradition, some of the conceptual planning of the city, the protection of the visual basin of the old city, the restoration of the walls of the old city. Those of you who've been to Jerusalem know that there is a bylaw mandating construction in stone. It came from an eccentric British governor by the name of Sir Ronald Storrs, who was a really interesting character. During the British Mandate, we began to see the emergence of Jerusalem as the epicenter of the conflict. You did have Israel, Jews and Arabs living side by side, but as the years progressed, beginning at the very beginning of the mandate, the conflict between Zionism and Palestinian nationalism began to focus on Jerusalem. And the conflict was played out in the streets of the old of Jerusalem. You had, for example, Jews living in the Muslim quarter of the old city, and they abandoned it after the uprising in 1929. I know from personal experience. My wife's grandmother was a real character. She was a suffragette schoolmarm Zionist who emigrated to Palestine from London in 1920. And she was the terror of the elites of Jerusalem because she was the English teacher of Gymnasia Rehavia. And when she arrived in Jerusalem, she discovered that the Ashkenazi of Rehavia weren't good enough for her, so she went to live among the Christian elites in Baca. That was the kind of thing that was thinkable, but when tensions rose, things began to sift out, and you began to see homogeneous neighborhoods of Jews, Arabs, but it was a patchwork. It was a patchwork of Israel, of Jewish, predominantly Jewish neighborhoods, alongside of a Palestinian neighborhood, Talbiya, alongside of Rehavia. So this divide geographically certainly did not exist. The partition plan called for the establishment of a Jewish state and an Arab state, and it skipped over Jerusalem. According to the UN resolution of 1947 and subsequently 1948, Jerusalem was neither to be part of the Jewish state nor of the Arab state. It was to be a corpus separatum. It was to be an international city. The Jewish residents would be citizens of Israel or the Jewish state, and the Palestinian citizens would be residents of the Arab state, but the rule would be international. It never took place for reasons I'll tell you in a moment. But it's important to bear in mind, this is really the last time that there was an internationally sanctioned border and status of Jerusalem. It never came to fruition, but until then, Jerusalem has been the quintessential contested city. By the way, if you look at this map, you'll also see that this is a gerrymandered map. No place on the planet except for maybe Chicago, is gerrymandering more important to the political instability and stability of the city. This is probably the last time in which the Christian equities were clearly expressed in the map making. This was a map that was made by Christians, and consequently you will note that it includes the old city and heads south towards Bethlehem and Ein Karem, but does not head north to Ramallah, where the Christians don't have anything to look for. There was an element of not trusting the jewels of civilization to natives, and the natives being Jews and Arabs. The corpus separatum was not to be, because even before the partition plan took effect, war erupted in the streets of Jerusalem. And that war played itself out in very bloody fighting. And Jerusalem, as a result of that, was torn asunder. Tens of thousands of Palestinians abandoned their home in neighborhoods in the western part of the city that had been predominantly, if not exclusively, Palestinian, the neighborhoods of Talbiya, Baca, Abu Tor, Katamon, things of that nature. By the way, also part of the geography of the city, Israel, since 1949, 1950, has attempted to give Israeli Hebrew names to these neighborhoods. Give At Hananya is Abu Tor, Komamiyut is Talbiya. Get into a cab, an Israeli cab, and ask to go to these places. They'll look at you. The Arab names have persisted. Almost all of the refugees in Jerusalem created by that war were indeed Palestinian, but there were Israeli refugees as well. The Old City fell. The Jewish quarter of the Old City fell. Its defenders and some of its inhabitants were taken were imprisoned in Jordan. And there were small Jewish enclaves, which are now figuring prominently again in places like Sheikh Jarrah, Neve Yaakov, Atarot, which were abandoned. So it was not entirely the situation where the refugees were all Palestinian. At the end of that war, Corpus Separatum was rejected because the parties coveted Jerusalem and sought possession over part of Jerusalem rather than a Jerusalem that would be ruled by an international body. And that congealed into the armistice line, what we now know as the Green Line, the armistice line that was set down in Rhodes in 1949, which created a Berlin-like divided city. The eastern part of the city, including the Old City and its visual basin, under Jordanian occupation. The Israeli western part of the city becoming the capital of Israel. Please note my terminology, Jordanian occupation. Israel, I believe, has occupied East Jerusalem since 1967. We did not invent the occupation of East Jerusalem, we merely perfected it. My friends who used to go to the movies in Jerusalem in 1950, something that's been almost impossible over the last decades because there are no movies theaters left. There's mirror images of the ultra-Orthodox and the ultra-Muslim becoming more dominant in both parts of the city. They would go to the movies, and each movie would begin with a trailer of the young King Hussein and the Jordanian national anthem fluttering in the breeze, and everybody would have to get to their feet and sing the Jordanian national anthem. And if you did not sing vehemently enough, the Mukhabarat, the Jordanian Secret Service, who were sitting in the back row, would haul you into interrogation, into the Kishla, the interrogation rooms in the basement of the Ottoman prison, which, by the way, is the same Ottoman prison in which we are now interrogating 15-year-old kids in the current uprising. So there is an element of cultural continuity in Jerusalem, at least in terms of interrogation rooms. As a matter of fact, archaeologists and excavations carried out recently have discovered a Herodian palace, which there's some conjecture may have been the site of the trial of Jesus. So apparently the interrogations have been going on there even longer than we had expected. Jerusalem, as we know from the Psalms, is to be celebrated above our highest joy. Jerusalem was a backwater on both the Israeli side of the line and on the Jordanian side of the line, and for different reasons. The Zionist movement has always had a love-hate relationship to the city of Jerusalem, representing the old order and the ultra-Orthodox. And to this day, if you stand on the corner of route number one at the exit of the city on a Thursday afternoon when the Knesset is in session, you can see the entire leadership of Israel leaving Jerusalem and going to where the real center of power is in Tel Aviv. It was a cul-de-sac city. There was one road in and one road out. The people in Tel Aviv to this day mock us, saying we roll up the sidewalks at 6 o'clock in the evening. Give you just a couple of small examples of the texture. My friends in Jerusalem don't know how to swim, people my age, because when they were growing up, there was one swimming pool, and it was at the YMCA, and it wasn't enough for the people of Jerusalem. And then there was one in Yimka in the 1960s. Or Jerusalemites on both sides of the line of my age have a habit. When they hear an airplane, they look up. Because when they were growing up, there was a no-fly zone of Jerusalem. And an airplane was a real novelty. So those are the kinds of habits that die hard. There was a mirror image on the Jordanian side of the line. Jerusalem was intentionally neglected by the Jordanians, because Jordan was an artificial construct. Amman was an artificial Brasilia-like city. And there always was the fear, and that fear remains, that Jerusalem, with its historical pedigree, would rival the legitimacy and ultimately undermine the legitimacy of the Hashemite kingdom of Jordan. So as a result of that, you had a city that was hermetically sealed. The armistice agreement provided that Israelis be allowed to go to the holy sites in the old city, but dirty little secret that the Palestinians could return to their homes in Israel. Both sides found it convenient, and there was this one checkpoint between the two parts of the city. There was some smuggling, but very, very little interaction. The war comes in 1967, and there's something subjective that I have to mention here, that if you don't try and reconstruct this period, it's very difficult to understand even the current dynamic.
Very bad manners for the interviewer to interrupt, but I wanted to ask another question at this point. I want to stop the story here.
Interrupt.
So Danny has taken us from the 1880s to 1967. We've seen a corpus separatum as an image on a piece of paper that never existed, and we've seen the reality of the armistice line, this kind of line down the heart of the city. Both sides suffered greatly in those years from 49 to 67. Both sides were underdeveloped. They were basically not very exciting places to be. I think that during that entire time, during the time from 49 to 67, there was a lot of uneasiness on both sides, people wondering, how long is this going to last? Isn't it possible? I know from reading sources on the Palestinian side that there was constant fear of invasion, and I'm sure that there was fear on both sides. So now we're up to 67. What happens in 67 that changes everything?
Just one brief comment. I very much agree with you. The presence of a border, the firing that went back and forth, there's an expression in Hebrew called Ovi Hakav. When they drew the border in Rhodes in 1949, they used a China graph, which became dull as you drew it. And as a result of that, by the time they drew the border near the old city, the width of the border was 20 to 30 yards wide. People died because of that, okay? Consequently, when Israel annexed East Jerusalem in 1967, we didn't draw a line. There are 30 pages of coordinates deposited in the safe of the foreign ministry so that we don't make the same mistake again. On the other hand, Israelis and Palestinians talk about Jerusalem between 49 and 67 as paradise lost, as a charming, delightful, small city and a gem. And both sides say the same. So there's a mirror images, okay? In 1967, Israel, I want to emphasize something subjective here. My office is on Hillel Street in Jerusalem, and just below my office is Independence Park, which was in large part the Maman Allah Mamilla Cemetery. And in 1967, during the period leading up to the 67 war, the chief rabbis came in the middle of the night and consecrated the park as a cemetery, because we anticipated tens of thousands of deaths in that war. The pall of potential Holocaust hung over Israel. After the war in 67, we found ourselves meeting with the biblical sites that had not been in Jewish control for 2,000 years. I think that the political ramifications of that have been disastrous for us. but it is a genuine and authentic experience, and without understanding this expression in Hebrew, mi igra rama lebira amikta, from a high to a low, this is precisely the opposite, from the threat of annihilation to the sense of salvation with biblical overtones. You will not understand the geopolitics of Jerusalem or the Republican presidential race unless you understand that. Israel did something in 1967, which in relationship to East Jerusalem that we did not do anywhere else in the West Bank. We annexed it, we purported to annex it. No other government on the planet recognizes the legitimacy of Israeli annexation. Now, if you will note, Jordanian Jerusalem was tiny. It was the green area over there. It was 6 square kilometers. I mean, you've got malls in the United States with more floor space than that. When you look at the annexed Jerusalem, Israel annexed not only the old city, Jordanian Jerusalem in the historic basin, but some 27 Palestinian villages that until then had been in the vicinity in Jerusalem. We said, Domini, 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 you're Jerusalemites. The considerations were classic labor Zionist considerations, as much land as possible and as few Palestinians as possible. In 1967, there were 195,000 Israelis living in Jerusalem, and in the newly defined borders, about 70,000 Palestinians. The Palestinians were about 25.5% of the population. Super important. We annexed the land of East Jerusalem. We did not annex the population. In 1949, Israel imposed its citizenship over the Palestinians who remained in Israel. It was an experiment that worked. There are Palestinian citizens of Israel. It is possible to be Palestinian and Israeli. The Palestinian citizens of Israel play on an Israeli chessboard. With all of the problems and all of the discrimination, Raad Salah would kill me for saying this, the head of the Islamic movement, Raad Salah is an Israeli. That is not the case of the Palestinians of East Jerusalem. We did not impose citizenship. We did not offer citizenship. They did not want citizenship. And that, I believe, was pivotal. I don't believe we could have. I believe that that was an inevitable in this situation. The Palestinians of East Jerusalem are not citizens of Israel, do not have the right to vote in national elections, do not have Israeli passports, and the clusters of their rights are substantively different from the Israelis who live in the city. It's not that they're rightless, but I would describe it as the Palestinians of East Jerusalem have alienable rights as opposed to the inalienable rights of Israelis. The Palestinians, by the way, of East Jerusalem can vote in municipal elections. And our illustrious Mayor Barkat prides himself as being elected by all of the residents of Jerusalem who elected him as mayor. Well, I'm a bit of a nudnik. I check. In the last elections, there were indeed 157,000 Palestinians who could vote for mayor, not for the Knesset. They could not become mayor. Of them, 1,101 cast a ballot. That's a 0.7% voter turnout. It's worse than Kansas, Dorothy. Of them, Mayor Barkat got 561 votes. Find a mishpocha, I know them very well, and he represents all of the residents of Jerusalem. It's an indication of the myth-making. Since 1967, Jerusalem, everything that has transpired in Jerusalem has been dictated by one thing. It's been dictated by the calculus of national struggle. How to consolidate a mantra. The mantra sounds perhaps ludicrous today, but think back to where we're coming from. From this threat of annihilation to salvation, the mantra is something that you all know, although you may not know that you know it. It is now prominent in the current presidential primaries in the Republican Party, and the mantra is Jerusalem, the capital of Israel, that will never be divided, which is one word and a noun, and you have to be able to recite it 7 times in a row in order to get the Republican nomination for president. Again, Jerusalem, the undivided capital of Israel, that will never be divided, which is one word and a noun. Okay. In order to make that true, Israel did everything in its power to guarantee that Jerusalem would remain an overwhelmingly Israeli city with a robust Israeli majority, the euphemism being to maintain the demographic balance of the city. Some facts and figures. Since 1967, Israel expropriated 35% of the privately owned land in East Jerusalem, overwhelmingly from Palestinians. We took lands that belonged to Palestinians and turned them into eminent domain for the purposes of establishing the large settlement neighborhoods, which are the blue patches that you see, of Gilo and East Talpiot and Ramot. On those lands, Israel built in excess of 53,000 homes for Israelis. We also built 600 homes for Palestinians, the last of which were the mid-1970s. Consequently, today there are 203,000 Israelis, 200,000 of which live in the large settlement neighborhoods of East Jerusalem, all part of the calculus of struggle to make the city indivisible, number one, and to guarantee the majority. There is an obverse to that. It is not only to accelerate Israeli development, but it is to put an artificial curb on Palestinian development. In 1967, there were 70,000 Palestinians in Jerusalem, and they lived in 12,600 homes. Today, there are in excess of 310,000 Palestinians in Jerusalem, more than quadrupled, and they live in excess of 55,000 homes, also more than quadrupled. But since then, Israel has issued less than 4,500 building permits. We have a curious theory that if we do not allow the Palestinians to build legally, they will lose interest in sex and childbearing and take up chess. There is little empirical evidence that that is succeeding. What this means is that overwhelmingly most of the Palestinian homes in East Jerusalem are liable for demolition, potentially because they have been built without legally sanctioned building permits, which are virtually impossible to get. What you see here is a patchwork of the political status of Jerusalem. It makes the Balkans at the worst look tame. You have West Jerusalem. You have East Jerusalem, which is the undivided capital of Israel for Israelis and occupied West Bank for much of the international community. Then you have the Oslo areas of Area A, Area B, and Area C. A being the brown area, Area B being the yellow areas. Ignore all of the barriers for a moment. If you simply take a compass and take a 20-kilometer radius from Haram al-Sharif, the Temple Mount, and count heads, you will discover that there is almost perfect arithmetic parity between Israelis and Palestinians, about 705,000 Palestinians and 695,000 Israelis, or the other way around. There are two national collectives living within the same geographical space, and that is the basic geopolitical fact of life in the city of Jerusalem.
So, to add to this problem, what can you tell us the story of the separation barrier? Where does that fit into the story?
During the Second Intifada, Jerusalem was a really dangerous place. Now, I would go to all of the neighborhoods of East Jerusalem and was welcome as an Israeli. There was no problem, something that I cannot do today. Maybe we can talk about that. The city has divided itself up for the last year and a half in ways that we have not seen before that. It was dangerous. My three daughters went to Beit Sefer Nisui about 100 yards away from my office, and my wife worked in an office another 100 yards away, we had our own private Bermuda Triangle. Within that triangle, during 2002, 3, 4, 5, there were 10 suicide bombings. Each of the kids knows somebody killed in that wave of terror, including classmates. There was a clamoring to do something, and the do something was to create a barrier that would prevent the incursion of suicide bombers from the West Bank into Jerusalem, by the way. Between 2001 and 2007, there were 270 Palestinians arrested in East Jerusalem and security-related offenses at a time where we had 11,000 detainees. The Palestinians of East Jerusalem did not participate in large numbers in the Second Intifada. It was coming from the outside. The problem is that we created a Balkanized Jerusalem. Were we to have remained within the contours or adjacent to the green line, that would have been achievable. Now, by the way, this has become an enormously controversial issue in terms of international law. The Israeli separation barrier cutting deep into the West Bank and the International Court of Justice determining that if you want to build a barrier, that's fine, do it on your own land or do it on the green line. If you look at the root of the barrier here, you are reminded of the quip that a camel is a horse planned by a committee. There are basically three concepts underlying the Jerusalem separation barrier, and they are: the concept is not to separate Israelis from Palestinians. Concept number one is much of the barrier hugs the municipal line as determined by Israel in 1967. But that line, until the barrier came across, was fictitious. Palestinians were part of Ramallah and Bethlehem and not part of West Jerusalem. Now, in Camp David in 2000, one of the few achievements of Ehud Barak was Jerusalem lost its virginity at Camp David. You could hear the mantra collapsing, and today it is common knowledge that Jerusalem is divided, and if there ever will be an agreement, will be politically divided. Part of the motivation of the construction of the barrier was to put it on the fictitious municipal line in a way that almost invariably separated Palestinian from Palestinian and did not separate Israeli from Israeli. The considerations were political and they were not operational. That is consideration number one. Then you have this unfortunate cloverleaf. If you look on this map, you will see that there's a large finger that extends to the north, deep into the West Bank. And you will have a similar one, a bubble that extends out to the east, cutting into the West Bank, and to the south. That is clearly a land grab. This is, again, it's basically part of a strategic thrust to create a unilateral border between Israel and Palestine that deviates considerably from the green line. And again, the rooting of this was dictated by geopolitical concerns of those who wanted to determine a permanent status border along lines that they considered to be the best of Israel's advantage. So this was also ulterior motive. And the third, I don't know how to use the clicker here, you'll notice that there are two areas in the northern part. There's a tongue that sticks into the city, and then there's the northern part of the city. In one area, we used the separation barrier to settle scores with a place that everybody loves to hate. It's called the Shuafat Refugee Camp. The Shuafat Refugee Camp, by the way, I love the place. It's just a fun place. But the Palestinian Authority hates it. UNRWA hates it. They hate UNRWA. And certainly we, and it's completely extraterritorial. Israel was never able to step foot into that refugee camp, so we cut them out. We gerrymandered the wall in order to cut them out, and in the northern part of the city, there are approximately 80,000 Palestinians today who live formally in Israeli Jerusalem, who formally have the rights and entitlements of Israelis, who can enter the city and exit the city, who receive Israeli healthcare, pay Israeli taxes, Israeli social welfare benefits and receive zero services from the government of Israel, none. No paving of roads, no construction of schools outside of the wall. And it's a state of limbo, okay? I believe that the construction of the barrier, and I hate to say I told you, so I predicted this at the time, has figured prominently in the current uprising. Because when you, aside from the settlement enterprise, cutting off East Jerusalem is the largest physical change that has taken place in or in relationship to East Jerusalem since 1967. And when you create physical changes like that, you also create conceptual changes. And we have cut off approximately 300,000 Palestinians from their hinterland in the West Bank. They are no longer integrated into that hinterland. But they are not integrated into Israel. They're a population afloat. And when you have 15-year-old kids going out and stabbing Israelis, a good deal of the motivation is a deep sense that they have no future because they live in a world that doesn't belong anywhere. So in some ways, I believe the separation barrier did have a positive impact to a certain degree in reducing the level of terror. It was also counterproductive.
So let's stick for a minute with these teenagers and their younger siblings who go to school without giving us the endless alphabet city of all the schools in Israel and the West Bank and East Jerusalem. Just see if we can simplify it. What do school children learn about the map of Jerusalem? What map do they see when they study the history of their city?
I will quote the Chief Justice of the Supreme Court, the Reed Boehner, the former one. I conducted a 10-year legal battle to get classrooms built in East Jerusalem. There's a shortfall of 2,000 classrooms in East Jerusalem. We don't build them. It's very simple. There's an ironclad rule of politics. Politicians will never allocate time, resources, energy, entitlements to people who can't or won't vote. And we were able to get a few hundred out of the couple thousand classrooms. It's climbing slippery walls. And the Supreme Court would not rule on this, but they used their leverage to the extent possible to bludgeon the Israeli government to do something. And at one point, Dorit Beinish accused the Minister of Education of reintroducing the Green Line into Jerusalem by not building schools well before she introduced it into the textbooks. When you have a zero-sum game, you enter into mutual denial. You will look hard-pressed to find expressions of Jewish attachments to Jerusalem in Palestinian textbooks. You will find very little about Muslim attachments in Israeli books, and certainly not the Green Line. And we now have a generation that did not know the 1967 border. On the other hand, the border in Jerusalem is as stark today as ever it was in the past, and in many ways, Jerusalem is as divided today without a physical boundary as it was in pre-1967.
When tourists come to Jerusalem and are given a tourist map of the city, what does it have on it?
I'll tell you about our next project, okay? There was a report this past week that the maps of Jerusalem being handed out by the Ministry of Tourism have something like 68 Jewish sites, including settler houses in the Muslim quarter of the Old City, 4 Christian sites, and 1 Muslim site. We are currently in a frenzy of mutual denial. I can show you a pamphlet put out by the Islamic Waqf in 1923, which prides itself on the fact that the mosque was built on the site of the Jewish temple. Try and elicit a confession like that out of the current Muslim leadership. It's very, very difficult. we spoke about this earlier, right before we're talking. What we are witnessing in Jerusalem today are the ascendancy of exclusionary, absolutist faith narratives, faith communities that weaponize faith, who claim to possess Jerusalem exclusively and marginalize the equities of other. Now, this is not a harangue of keep religion out of Jerusalem. Saying keep religion out of Jerusalem is like saying keep culture out of Florence or finance out of Manhattan. Jerusalem is Jerusalem because of God, whether she exists or not. What the difficulty is that we have seen the marginalization of the traditional religious establishments, and by them I mean the chief rabbinate, the Vatican, the traditional historical Protestant churches, and the Sharia courts, who understood that Jerusalem speaks in multiple voices, and they are being replaced by the weaponizers, the biblically driven settlers, the messianically driven Temple Mount movement, the end of days dispensationalist Christians, and the nastier wing of the Brotherhood. What our next project is, we have just completed a database of all of the sacred and religious sites in and around the Old City. It's remarkable. Nobody's done that before. We talk about, by the way, not three religions, but four. It's Judaism, Christianity, and Islam, with all of the different denominations, but it's also secular humanism. The Romans, the Persians, and the Jebusites need to be represented in Jerusalem as well. Decision makers who have negotiated the future of Jerusalem have known the Church of the Holy Sepulchre, Haram al-Sharif, the Temple Mount, and the Western Wall. There is a festering conflict that may put Jews on a collision course with Christians in the Cenaculum on Mount Zion, which is traditionally the hall of the Last Supper. It is also King David's tomb, and it's also the site of a rather eccentric yeshiva. And this is beginning to emerge as the younger sibling of the conflict on the Temple Mount. You will never understand that conflict if you don't know that when the Ottomans took over that site in the 16th century, for years, Franciscan monks hid in the basement in order to maintain the connection to that site. And what we're seeing is Jerusalem is a stable city when it speaks in multiple voices. When Jerusalem is possessed in the name of a higher order and one group establishes hegemony, it's hell for everybody else and it's dangerous for the rest of the world.
Is there a future for Christians, not for Christianity, but for Christians in Jerusalem?
It's a great question. In 1948, on the eve of the end of the British Mandate, there were 38,000 Christians in Jerusalem, about 20% of the population. Today, nobody quite knows, but apparently the number is 12,000, 8,000 of whom are Palestinian, and there are a lot of internationals. There are more Palestinian Christian Jerusalemites in Chicago than there are in Jerusalem. Now, it is extremely difficult to get an honest analysis of why this is happening, because our Hasbaristas will say, it's them, they're Muslims who are out there. This is the same. What's happening in Jerusalem is because of the Muslims, just like it's happening in Iraq. And you will have the Israel bashers saying, this is just the exclusionary Zionists, it's all the fault of Zionism. Yes, there is hate crime. Yes, priests are being spat upon on Mount Zion, and there is some level of harassment. For example, intercommunal warfare led by certain Islamic groups, for example, in Ashayach. But that's not the issue. The Christian community is doubly and triply vulnerable in the eyes of Israelis. The Palestinian Christians are Arabs and are treated as such, and in the eyes of Muslims, they're Christian. They have greater opportunity. I consider that to be one of the gravest threats to the not only the integrity of Jerusalem, but the stability of Jerusalem. The Christian community of Jerusalem is today the canary in the coal mine. When the Christian community is ill, and it is ill, we are all ill, we just don't know it yet. So I believe that the revitalization of Christian institutions and Christian communities is an imperative. And again, so much of this is done without malice. I know how to point out the malice in the city. And believe me, we have industrial quantities of malice in Jerusalem. This is more often than not done without malice. Let me just give one story, okay? About 2 years ago, I get a phone call at 7:30 in the morning. The electric company put up a humongous electrical pylon slap dab in front of Gethsemane, marring the view between Gethsemane at the foot of the Mount of Olives and the Old City. Staggering. Now, number one, I don't believe it. Because unless you examine, everybody, one of the ways that Jerusalem's egalitarian, everybody lies about the city. So if you get a report, go out, Jews, Christians, and Muslims, Israelis, and Palestinians will lie, go out and make sure that it's there. I get there, and I'm just super appalled because there are two huge electrical cables coming out there. One says Ma'alez 18, the other says Ir David. This was put there to bring electric power specifically to the settlement so that Israelis and Palestinians in the same neighborhood would be getting electricity from different electric companies, narrowing the comfort zone between Israel and a certain regime that I'm not allowed to mention, the A word, narrowing it, giving new meaning to the term Jewish power. Now, could this have happened in the days of the illustrious Teddy Kollek? Of course it could, because not every engineer in the Israeli electric company knows the New Testament. Today, more engineers in the Israeli electric company know the New Testament because they're Christian immigrants from the Soviet Union, but that's another issue entirely, okay? But had that happened when Teddy was alive, Teddy would have bellowed at 7:35 in the morning, "Take the damn thing down." No, we didn't. The Franciscans went to court and had a long, dragged-out court battle. You know why it was taken down? The Pope came. It takes a Pope. In the past, there were decision-makers in the prime minister's office, in the intelligence community, in the mayor's office, who saw protection of the religious equities of Christians and of Muslims as of primary strategic importance to Israel. That is no longer the case.
My last question before we open it up to the audience. In the past, there were decision makers. Are there any decision makers in the present who can help us toward a two-state solution, or is that a thing of the past?
I'll give you an oblique answer. I mentioned to you that Israel made 270 arrests between January 1, 2001 and December 31st, 2007. Between Erev Rosh Hashanah, September 13th of last year, and October 31st, there were 797 arrests in East Jerusalem. I've been crunching the figures. Israel has arrested around 1.5% of all of the Palestinian boys under the age of 18, and I'm counting the infants in that, okay? That is a staggering number. And we're in the midst of a popular uprising, the likes of which we have not seen since 1967. And nobody in official Israel is genuinely asking the question, why? Because we are still committed to an article of faith of an undivided Jerusalem that doesn't exist in nature. And if you are committed to that article of faith, we have a prime minister, a government, and a mayor who detach themselves from the empirical realities of the city. Nowhere on the planet is there a prime minister or a mayor who are completely out of touch. In August of 2014, every neighborhood in East Jerusalem was on fire on a nightly basis, and the mayor went off to the Ferrari plant in Italy on vacation. It's like the mayor of Ferguson going to Waikiki during the rioting. It's just staggering. The Israeli opposition is not articulating an alternative. We now have a plan by the head of the opposition, Herzog, and by Chaim Ramon. Let's solve the problem by cutting out another 200,000 Palestinians from East Jerusalem, doubling down on occupation. I've been the leading advocate of a conflict-ending political division of the city, end of occupation in exchange for legitimacy, security, and a border. The forces of moderation in Israel are calling, basically, they're saying, the problem isn't occupation, it's that Netanyahu is doing occupation poorly, we'll do it better. And then you have the people who agree with me who are saying, yes, an occupation is also a problem. There is nobody. I consider occupation to be the greatest existential threat to the Jewish people in this generation. Israel can deflect any series of external threats. We have operational responses to Iran and Hezbollah. We do not have operational answers to a 15-year-old kid who's willing to die. And he's willing to die because he lives an unsustainable life without a future. And unfortunately, there are only people within civil society who are beginning to articulate that. And there have been periods in Israeli history since 67 in which occupation was a disease in remission. It was tolerable. We exported some of our humanistic and democratic values after 1967. That's not the case. It's metastasizing today. And regrettably, you have, on occasion, people like the late Meir Dagan. Meir Dagan was not a vegetarian. Meir Dagan was, look, he passed away recently. I won't say it. He was a very aggressive guy. And he spoke like I did. He died 2-3 weeks ago, fearing for the existence of Israel because Israel cannot survive as a perpetually occupying power. Now, we have a prime minister who says, I support the two-state solution, but I support any compromise in Jerusalem. There is a literal translation to that. I oppose the two-state solution, but for reasons known only to myself, I'm not going to tell you that. This conflict may never end. If it ends, we know what the deal is. It ends in a border. A border is the only way of ending occupation, and that border will be inside Jerusalem. We know where it goes. It already exists. And there is nobody inside the political arena in Israel today articulating that.
So I was saying I have a question about Israel, the undivided eternal capital of Jerusalem that will never, ever be divided. And that
not good enough. You're not going to get elected.
Yeah, I didn't say it fast enough. So I want to ask, I mean, I know we can look at that map and we can sort of see where a border might be. And I understand that, you agree that a border is the only way to solve this. So I want to ask, how about in the old city specifically, within the walls, do you think it is possible to draw a border such that, for example, the Jewish quarter of Jerusalem remain a part of Israel and perhaps the surrounding quarters be part of Palestine? Do you think it's reasonable or feasible to divide inside the walls of the old city?
I really thank you for that. If you look at the negotiations that were carried out, not by the kibbutzers like me, but by the principals, Barak, Olmert, Abbas, there's very little disagreement about where to put the border in municipal Jerusalem. When you get to the old city, there are two pure models that have emerged, and they're both have huge advantages and huge disadvantages. One of them is divide sovereignty in the old city. The Jewish quarter, the Western Wall, and access to the Jewish quarter will be under Israeli sovereignty, and the remaining parts of the old city will be under Palestinian sovereignty. That is the direction that President Clinton went in, the Clinton parameters. Barak is in agreeing to that, and Abbas's proposal at Annapolis. The other is zero sovereignty, deferred sovereignty, suspended sovereignty, or divine sovereignty. It's basically a return to a mini corpus separatum called special regime. And that is the proposal made by Olmert to Abbas in the Annapolis process. Olmert proposed that there would be no sovereignty in and around the Old City, but it would be run by a consortium of the United States, Jordan, Israel, Palestine, and Saudi Arabia. Both have enormous advantages. Dividing sovereignty is final. It has clarity. It has end of claims. Israelis and Palestinians have possessive urges, and nowhere are possessive urges greater than in and around the Old City. On the other hand, you will agree with me that Israelis and Palestinians have not been blessed with Scandinavian temperaments, and we need a responsible adult, and we're going to poke each other's eyes out, and we're going to mortally wound the Old City. On the other hand, I very much doubt that Israelis or Palestinians will be satisfied by turning the keys over to the family jewels to a clueless Norwegian. But both of these models are possible. And what's interesting is you will find Israelis who support both, and you will find Palestinians. This does not break down along national lines. Neither of these models really exists in nature. They're on a continuum. And I think that the most likely result, if and when there will be negotiations in good faith, is a model which I call special arrangements. By the way, I think it's been adopted as the preferred solution by the American government. And that is a hybrid of the two. There will be no physical borders within the Old City. There will be a political border. The physical border will be on the perimeter. The Old City will not be wounded. But every inch will be binary, either Israel or Palestine. But in areas that are sensitive to the national conflict, such as access to holy sites, the integrity of holy sites, archaeology, and things of that nature, each party will cede its sovereign authority to a disinterested and powerful party. So you will have components of a division of sovereignty with a certain international involvement where it's important. And I think that would be the most likely result.
How seriously do you consider the threat to the status quo on the Table Mount, given the growing settler influence over the government and the very aggressive efforts to upset that status quo?
I'm very concerned. I'm extremely concerned. And this is something that I've been monitoring for many years. Let me just contextualize things, because the Temple Mount movement in many ways have portrayed themselves as Rosa Parks getting onto the bus. Well, Rosa Parks did not threaten to throw the white folks off the bus and burn the bus. Let me just give you four vignettes that I think will describe where we're coming from. What was the status quo on the Temple Mount during the British Mandate? There wasn't one, because the status quo is an operational term when there are contested claims. There were no Jewish claims on the Temple Mount during the Mandate. Nobody asked to pray there. Nobody asked for anything. There were deep Jewish attachments. You'll find the Temple Mount appearing in the poetry of the mandatory period, but there were no claims. Fast forward, 1967. The paratroopers take the Temple Mount at 10 o'clock in the morning. 2 o'clock in the afternoon, Moshe Dayan arrives and sees Israeli flags fluttering from the Al-Aqsa Mosque in the Dome of the Rock, and he barks, "Take those down and never put them up again. We don't need a religious war." That is now bemoaned as a tragic mistake in Israel. His decision then was basically the creation of the status quo, which is that the stability of the Temple Mount means that it should be a Muslim place of worship, exclusively a Muslim place of worship, with a good deal of Islamic waqf autonomy that is open to respectful visits from non-Muslims. Fast forward again. 1980, I'm in the Israeli army and a commander of a course of officers, and part of our course was on a visit to Jerusalem to take them to the Temple Mount. So I would go to the Temple Mount with 30, 40 officers in uniform, and I would have to pay. There was an entrance fee at the time. I paid with a payment voucher of the Israeli army. I'd give them one copy too. They would fill it out in Arabic. I would fill it out in Hebrew. Now, they needed my visit like they needed a case of herpes. But it was respectful, it was dignified, and it worked. Fast forward again, a year and a half ago, our minister of construction at the time, now Minister of Agriculture, Uri Ariel, is a member of a cabinet, and that cabinet supports a consistent Israeli policy that Jews do not pray on the Temple Mount. That is the government that he's a member of. He decides to go to the Temple Mount to pray. He tells Netanyahu he's doing so, and nothing happens. He gets to the Temple Mount, and he prays. Now, from the limited contacts that I have with God in recent years, I understand one is allowed to pray quietly, but he's a bit like the ultra-Orthodox in international travel. Have you ever noticed that the ultra-Orthodox Jews can only pray over 30,000 feet because it does not otherwise sufficiently annoy the other passengers? It's not enough that you're pious. It has to be aggravated, demonstrable piety. So he does the priestly blessing to make sure that everybody knows that he's praying. And then he goes on camera and said, I would be delighted in my capacity as Israel's minister of construction to see the third temple built. Now, just in case this will not be picked up, it was not picked up in Israel, it was picked up in Tehran, it was picked up in Cairo and throughout the Arab world, he posts it on YouTube. Now, that's pyromania, okay? What we have seen, Netanyahu is right. In the framework of the maintenance of a technical status quo, we have seen a radical change in the substantive status quo with a non-contested site becoming the contested site, and it's being contested by people in positions of authority and people in power in Israel. Netanyahu, over the last couple of years, I believe, gets good grades on this. He arrives at understandings with the King Abdallah, and then over time they begin to unravel because of the internal pressures. My fear is as follows. Israel is not responsible for the trends of religious radicalization globally. It's happening throughout the region. It's happening throughout the world. Jerusalem is one of the epicenters of that. It's the arena of choice. And the trends of radicalization that we're witnessing are stronger than any individual responsible policy of a national leader. They're huge. And they require a good deal more of attention. And regrettably, we're not seeing that. Among else, it means restoring the high ground to the traditional religious establishments who have been marginalized. But the situation is very dangerous. Now, I was thinking of introducing it with this. There was this idea that came up, Kerry came up with it a few months ago, or agreed to it, to put cameras on the Temple Mount, so we'll see what's happening. Now, there's this almost magical belief that only we will know what's happening, things will get better. The cameras have not been installed because the Palestinian it was not coordinated with the Palestinians, and the Palestinian kids said, we're going to destroy them because Israel's going to use this to arrest us. But what people don't understand is, it's clear what would happen if you would have Netanyahu sitting in the prime minister's office in Jerusalem watching the footage streamed to him, and King Abdallah in the palace in Jordan. Netanyahu would say, look at this, we're maintaining the status quo. And Abdallah would see in the film footage and say, look at these Israelis, they're totally undermining the status quo. None of these things, there is no gimmick that is capable of replacing goodwill and forces of moderation, and both of those things are very lacking in contemporary Jerusalem.
This is something I want to know what you would feel about it, because of when it comes to Palestinians, there was a Jew who invited them in. For a long time, so I want to know what you would be feeling about it. About inviting all the Palestinians into at that time to actually inviting all of them in among the Jews and so forth.
I will try and answer the question, even though I'm not quite sure I understand it. But if and when there will be an agreement, it will be, I don't talk about peace agreement, I talk of end of claims agreement, I talk of permanent status agreement, it will be the least romantic agreement in history. Israelis would really love to drive the Palestinians into the desert to die of thirst. And the Palestinians would love to drive us into the sea to drown. Neither of those options is immediately available. The two-state solution is the fallback option. It is a way of getting rid of one another. My friend, the former head of Israeli intelligence, Shlomo Gazit, used to say to me, I never liked the Oslo agreement because I never knew if it was a marriage or divorce. Israelis or Palestinians are heading for a divorce. there will be a border in Jerusalem or there will be no agreement. It will not be a virtual border. I will need to present a passport in order to visit my friends in Sheikh Jarrah or Silwan. This is not going to be a shared Jerusalem. It will be politically divided. Having said that, that is the only way of ending occupation. Once that happens, the day that border goes up is the day that that border begins to unravel. Jerusalem has enormous healing capacity. It has hidden webs of veins and arteries that connect Israelis who do get along, who do respect each other, something that is socially unacceptable even to say in contemporary Jerusalem. That cannot happen as long as occupation is metastasizing. 10 years after the border goes up, you will see Jerusalem healing much more rapidly and in ways that we can't possibly imagine today. So my view is not pessimistic. We need radical surgery. After that radical surgery, the healing can begin and the healing is possible.
Well, there's an expression, I don't think it's in Hebrew, that the devil is in the details, and we are very grateful to Danny Seidemann for giving us the details that underlie the conflict in Jerusalem and the prospects for peace. I think Danny could probably keep going quite a bit longer because there's a lot more detail to share, but you might get some more words out of him, and we invite you all upstairs to the reception in the Four Freedoms Room. His NGO, Terrestrial Jerusalem, has available for you copies of his book, A Geopolitical Atlas of Contemporary Jerusalem. We're enormously grateful to Professor Laura Schor for interviewing Danny, keeping him on track. And on behalf of Roosevelt House, our distinguished director, Harold Hulzer, please come upstairs to the Four Freedoms Room and join us for a glass of wine or water. Thank you.